One of the pieces of this, and I know this is of great interest to you especially with your arts background, is a lot of people see that when the money is lost at schools, it's lost in such things as the arts, the education for the arts.
Yes, I find it really appalling that people talk about the arts as extracurricular, because
appalling
because not only are the arts part of a broad education so that a person is indeed well-rounded and well-educated, but the arts are a way for people to gain confidence. I think all of us at some point had to play that recital or be involved in that school play and learn the lines and learn how to stand up in front of an audience and do a performance, and it makes it easier later in life when you have to do those things. Children get real satisfaction out of achieving in the arts, and it ought to be a part of our public school, school and private school.
Why do you think it's often the first cut?
Well, because many people, I think, don't understand its relationship to education, to development, but also everybody understands that you have to be able to read, you have to be able to write, you have to be able to do math and to learn science. Let's just remember that a total human being is more than that, and that it is as important that you're confident in what you're doing than anything else. And so I'm a big believer that the arts should be kept in the schools, and to the degree that they're not, that there need to be private interventions on behalf of the arts in our schools.
You ran a big system. These are tough choices, right, when it gets down to where you put the money.
They are tough choices. I'm pleased to say in New York, under Mayor Bloomberg's leadership, we increased spending significantly on the arts. Even as we focused heavily on literacy and numeracy, we increased spending. It's got to be part of an overall educational system. One of the things we did in New York was to extend the day, extend the year. And, you know, if we keep the time fixed, there may not be enough time to do all of the things, because the arts are obviously critical. Science is critical. In the report, we point out foreign languages and making them available. So the problem we have is we have a lot to do and not a lot of time in the school day to do it. And that's where I think we need to think as well about a model that grew up 100 years ago that may not be appropriate to today's world. In Korea.
You mean in terms of the number of hours?
Number of hours. In Korea, these kids are in school a whole lot longer. And obviously that says something about where their values are and where their concerns are. And we've got an old agricultural model. I mean, we literally, kids used to work in a farm before they came to school and harvest the crop in the summer. But our kids don't harvest crop in the summer.
But doesn't that go to the whole, I mean, the whole history of education here is local, right? And you're talking about nationalizing, in some sense, a kind of, at least conceptually, and even some standards. Aren't you going to run up against a traditional sense of federalism?
I think we're not going to run up against it, but I think we're going to ask people to think about it differently in a world in which we face different challenges. Federalism is important. That's why the report says these Common Core standards should be led by the governors. But we need real national standards. A governor in Alabama has got to say, my kids need to know as much as a kid in New York or in Florida, because that's the real world. And we're not doing ourselves a favor by undereducating our kids. Right now, today, 3/4 of our kids graduate high school, but only half of those kids are ready for college. So what are we doing? Giving them a diploma, but not giving them the knowledge and the expertise they're going to need to succeed.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.